Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the All-Beneficent, the All-Merciful. Nuqoosh Ismat, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Part 2. Treaty of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Motives and factors. With regard to the lifetime of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba, peace be upon him, the issue of polygamy is most important from the aspect of exposing the propaganda of enemies. And the issue of peace treaty is important from the aspect of understanding the realities. After a detailed discussion on polygamous marriages, some discussion is required on the issue of the peace treaty as well. Basically, we should not ignore the fact that in both these issues, the role of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, is exactly like that of the Messenger of Allah. He is also made a target of ridicule with these issues. Sometimes the enemy had considered sensuality as the reason behind multiple marriages, and sometimes apparently friends have doubted in his prophethood with regard to a peace treaty. And in this way, the unity of grandfather and grandson has occurred involuntarily, even though the enemy would not like to confess it. In order to examine the peace treaty of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, it is necessary to keep in mind the background that after the martyrdom of Amirul Mu'mineen, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, peace be upon him, on 21st Ramadan, 40th year after Hijrah, and after his burial, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, addressed the Muslim crowd in a brief but comprehensive sermon. O people, tonight has passed away, one who is neither preceded by anyone in the past from the aspect of deeds and character, nor the future ones will ever do. He was a stalwart of the battlefield who fought jihad on the side of Holy Prophet, peace be upon him and his pure progeny. He used to defend him, and when he gave him the standard and sent him to the battlefield, he was accompanied by Jibra'il on the right and Mikael on the left, and he did not return till he gained decisive victory. He passed away on the night on which Isa ibn Maryam was raised to the heavens, and on the night Yusha ibn Nun passed away. He had left behind no wealth. He set aside an amount of only 700 dirhams to purchase a slave, but which did not take place. Reference Amali, Sheikh Saduq and Sheikh Mufid, Tafsir Furat. O people, one who knows me, and one who does not know me should recognize me, that I am Hasan ibn Ali, son of the Messenger of Allah, son of the successor of the Prophet, son of the Warner, and the giver of glad tidings. I am the one who invited to God and who was the luminous lamp. I am included among the Ahlul Bayt, from whom Almighty Allah has kept away all impurities and whom He has purified fully and whose love is fixed as the recompense of prophethood. Goodness is in fact love for us Ahlul Bayt. As soon as the sermon ended, Qais ibn Asad said, Sir, please extend your hand. We would like to pledge allegiance to you in the name of Book of Allah, Sunnah of the Prophet, and fighting against the enemies. He said, Only Book of Allah and Sunnah of the Prophet, and other things are included in it, and there is no need of any addition, as it would be a sign of deficiency of Quran and Sunnah. When you pledge allegiance to me, you would have to fight one whom I fight and make peace with one with whom I make peace. 40,000 persons gave allegiance to Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and he, in addition to being the owner of actual Imamat, also became the master of apparent caliphate. But Muawiyah, who had declared his rebellion in the Battle of Siffin, and according to his view, had even obtained the Islamic caliphate through arbitration, and in order to clear his way for absolute rulership, had got Imam Ali martyred through Ibn Muljim. He learned of this fact that the rulership of Iraq was again going towards the descendant of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. So he again started his intrigue and set out with an army of 60,000 to attack Kufa. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, sent an army of 12,000 men under the command of Qais ibn Sa'd to stop the march of Muawiyah. Muawiyah employed his natural deceit and spread rumors in the armies of Qais and Imam Hasan that peace treaty had been signed with Muawiyah and fighting was now futile. It was rumored in the army of Qais that Imam Hasan had made peace and Qais was fighting without any reason, and in the camp of Imam Hasan it was rumored that Qais had made peace and Imam Hasan was fighting for no reason. In this way, discord was created among both the armies, and those who had blamed Imam Ali, peace be upon him, for apostasy now accused Imam Hasan for the same, and finally conditions worsened so much so that the prayer mat was pulled out from under Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and he was harassed a great deal. And when he was proceeding to Madain, he was attacked and wounded, and he had to undergo a treatment for some time. Reference: Biharul Anwar, Volume 10, Chapter 9, page 269. Now Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, faced the following circumstances. First, after the martyrdom of Amirul Mu'mineen, Muawiyah was emboldened further and he got a chance to strengthen arbitration, and Muslims also found ways to gain wealth. Second, a severe discord emerged in the forces of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and people became fed up with wars. Hopes of gaining war booties waned. Muawiyah purchased the loyalties of the army chiefs of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and even persons like Ubaidullah ibn Abbas turned dishonest. And if other chiefs sold their conscience for 50,000, he sold it for 100,000. That is 1 lakh. Third, material as well as spiritual strength of the enemy increased. From the material aspect, their numbers increased, they got more wealth, and from spiritual aspect, all became more loyal to their ruler and were prepared to do anything for him, no matter how obvious his faults would be. Fourth, troubles that befell at Madain and lack of support of his men further worsened the conditions, and no possibility remained for more confrontation. Fifth, safety of the lives of Muslims in any case is the responsibility of the ruler, and he has no right to fight jihad till victory is not assured or the sacrifice is to the advantage of faith. For Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, there was no possibility of apparent victory, and sacrifice also had no benefit, as only a few sincere supporters remained who would also perish in due course, and no true Muslim would remain. The most important point is that Muawiyah himself, despite his deceptions, was thinking that it is not possible to humble Hasan ibn Ali, and without his approval, his rulership was valueless. Thus, he adopted the method of reconciliation, and displaying absolute trust, sent him a signed blank paper to make peace with him on the Imam's conditions. Now, Imam Hasan faced a dilemma that if he refused the offer, it would be against the spirit of Islam, and if he agreed, it would create more furor in the army. Thus, he placed the issue before his supporters that if you are still prepared to fight, I am ready to do jihad for the completion of argument. But if you are fond of life, with whom should I fight? The army shouted the slogan of peace immediately, and he realized that it was time of the peace treaty which his grandfather had prophesied about him. Thus, he approved the treaty and wrote down the following conditions. Reference: Ilamuddin Dailami, Biharul Anwar, Volume 8, Chapter 10, page 241. First, rulership would remain with Muawiyah provided he acted according to the Book of Allah and Sunnah of the Prophet. Reference: Ibn Abil Hadid. Second, Muawiyah would not have any right to appoint anyone as heir apparent. Reference: Isaba al-Imama wal-Siyasa. Third, people of Iraq would be given full peace. Reference: Hayatul Haywan. Fourth, Muawiyah would not bear the title of Amirul Mu'mineen. Reference: Tazkira Khawasul Ummah. Fifth, testimonies would not be given to Muawiyah. Reference: Ayanush Shia. Sixth, cursing of Imam Ali would be discontinued. Reference: Sharhe Nahjul Balagha. Seventh, every rightful person would get his right. Reference: Manaqib. 8th, Shia will be assured peace and security. Reference: Tabari. 9th, the tax of Ahwaz will be given to those who are killed in Jamal and Siffin. Reference: Al-Imama wal-Siyasa. 10th, public treasury of Kufa will remain under the control of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Reference: Tariq Duwalul Islam. 11th, Muawiyah will pay him 1000 dirhams annually. Reference, Jawharul Kalam. 12th, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and the family of Ahlul Bayt will not be harassed in any way. Reference, Bihar. Obviously, when a proposal of peace is made, keeping under view the above conditions, and if agreement is shown to such conditions, fighting cannot be justified for anyone, and every justice-loving person is supposed to make peace, whatever its consequences may be. Further, there was harm to the world as well as religion in rejecting peace. From the worldly aspect, nothing would have been gained except death of sincere companions and family members. From religious aspect, one would have been answerable for each death, as declaration of war without favorable conditions is nothing short of suicide and bloodshed. Such examples of silence and peace were present during the lifetime of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his pure progeny, as well as that of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. On the contrary, Holy Prophet had accepted the conditions of idolaters and made peace, upon which Omar had expressed his anger and cast doubts on his prophethood also. Therefore, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, accepted the peace treaty. After that, the issue of the battle of Imam Hussein was completely different, as no peace was proposed to him. On the contrary, Yazid demanded directly allegiance from him, which only meant destruction of religion, and in such condition, jihad becomes obligatory. Otherwise, during lifetime of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and after his martyrdom, in both circumstances, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, honored the terms of the treaty of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, and did not declare any kind of jihad, which clearly means that peace and war are same type of acts, seen as reaction to falsehood. If it proposes peace, it is accepted, and if it demands allegiance, life is sacrificed for it. Antecedents of the peace treaty. A study of the antecedents of the peace treaty is sufficient, as it clearly makes one realize why Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, agreed for peace and what type of consequences he wanted to obtain through this. In brief, it is sufficient to state that the aim of Ali Muhammad was nothing but protection of Sharia and Islam. They have made efforts for this same thing all their lives, and all their moves were only aimed at this. Sometimes they fulfilled it by taking over rulership like Amirul Mu'mineen did on the occasion of fourth stage of caliphate, and sometimes they did it by giving up rulership, as it happened during the peace treaty of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Sometimes this duty was fulfilled by eliminating the enemies, as in the cases of Battle of Badr and Uhud, and sometimes it was done by laying down one's life, as happened in Masjid Kufa. On the contrary, sometimes both methods were combined, as happened in the Battle of Karbala. If sometimes contradiction is seen in the acts of Ali Muhammad, it is also as a result of the fulfillment of this aim. It cannot be compared to the contradiction of the character, as its examples are available in divine practices as well as the life of the history of Prophet. When Providence wanted to protect the lives of the Prophet, it did not save the hands of Musa from the embers and they were scarred. And sometimes it saved Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, from an inferno. The Messenger of Allah also sometimes displayed the power in the battlefields of Badr and Uhud, and sometimes he agreed to extraordinary treaties which even the great companions could not understand. The only issue was defense of faith. Defense depends on circumstances, and circumstances continue to change. Imam Hasan had seen it as a good opportunity of making peace, as he had seen how the person whose father created furor at each of the conditions proposed by his grandfather, that same person had sent him a blank paper and agreed to all conditions, which is the first announcement of my victory and a nice possibility for me to write the conditions and prepare an excellent document which would also interpret the intentions of both parties till the day of judgment, and also guide anyone who is searching for truth. Thus, by making peace, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, derived the following advantages. First, it was as if Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, appointed Muawiyah who was an enemy of Islam from the side of both his grandparents, as a defender of Islam. And now, instead of considering it as an inheritance of Ali Muhammad, he began to consider it as his own property and became ready to defend it. As some elders say that if you want to preserve something in the locality, you should keep it with one from whom there is risk of robbery and it would be safe. Second, it had always been the practice of oppressors that as soon as circumstances change, they deny their previous manners and begin to prove themselves as infallible. By laying down the condition of stopping the cursing of Imam Ali, peace be upon him, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, wanted to show that what type of treatment was meted out to the self of the Prophet under Syrian power and what victimizations Ali Muhammad had continued to face. Third, the most important fact of Islamic rule is that it should be based on Quran and Sunnah. Other than this, no regime can be called Islamic. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, imposed the first condition that you will have to act according to Quran and Sunnah of the Prophet, which clearly showed that it was not being practiced in Syria before that. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, wanted to stress that he did not aim rulership. His only aim was that rule should be according to Quran and Sunnah. It is the duty of every Muslim to protect the life and property of other Muslims and adopt all ways which is not opposed to the laws of Sharia. Imam Hasan knew that the ruler of Sham would in any way try to eliminate his supporters, and the best way to defend their lives was to sign this peace treaty. And it was up to Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, to prepare this document. Thus, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, secured those lives through this which would have not even been possible through weapons and great forces, as had become clear through experiences of history. Although this cannot be compared to the battles of Jamal and Siffin, that is why Amirul Mu'mineen did not defend the lives of his supporters. It is so because in Jamal and Siffin, the foe was in attack mode and there was no choice but to put up an armed confrontation, and there was no offer of peace as in case of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. On the contrary, even in Siffin, when Qurans were raised on spears and there was possibility to halt hostilities, Amirul Mu'mineen stopped fighting and did not give the enemy any further chance of bloodshed. Although he was aware of Muawiyah's intention, and he was also aware of the stopping of hostilities. Fifth, as a result of this peace treaty, the followers of Ahlul Bayt got some respite and they began to publicize their laws, and in this way they began to propagate their faith directly. Thus, the declaration of the Vilayat of Imam Ali in the Azan was a link of this chain, that when Muawiyah began cursing Imam Ali, peace be upon him, from the pulpits, followers of Imam Ali, peace be upon him, started announcing the guardianship of Imam Ali, peace be upon him, from the minarets, so that all should know that this cursing is in not against any ordinary person. It is against Wali of God, whom Quran has declared to be a Wali of God, and to curse a Wali of God is same as challenging Almighty Allah to war, after which no value remains for Islam, and Muawiyah does not remain a Muslim from any aspect. Memorable debate of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Allamah Tabrizi, the author of Ihtijaj, writes that according to the report of Abi Mikhnaf, Shoba and Yazid ibn Abi Habib Misri, no debate took place in Islam greater than that which occurred in the court of Muawiyah on the day Amr bin Uthman ibn Affan, Amr ibn As, Utbah bin Abu Sufyan, Walid ibn Uqba and Mughayra bin Shu'bah gathered and decided to summon Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba, peace be upon him, and rebuke and insult him. So Amr ibn al-As told Muawiyah about his plan. Muawiyah said that it was something beyond their capacity and that all of them would themselves be disgraced instead. However, the audience insisted and Muawiyah sent for the holy Imam. Imam asked the messenger about the situation, recited supplication for refuge against the Satans, and set out from his place. When he reached Muawiyah's court, the latter extended a warm welcome to him and gave him a seat of honor. "Why am I called here?" asked Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Muawiyah replied, "These people wanted your presence here because they claim that Uthman was killed unjustly and that your father had him assassinated. So you must listen to what they have to say and reply to their assertions. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, said, "This is your court. If you have permitted them to speak, you will have to listen to the reply also. And in any case, you will have to be ashamed from one or the other side. If I knew, I would also have bought the same number of persons from Bani Hashim. But no matter, Allah would help me. Let them say whatever they want. I shall answer all by the might and power of the Almighty." Immediately, Amr bin Uthman began his tirade and first spoke of the proximity and status of Uthman with respect to Holy Prophet. Then he claimed that the clan of Bani Hashim, due to the malice they harbored against him, had him assassinated, and what a shameful thing that a caliph should be murdered and his killer should roam free. "You people still have to pay for 19 murders from our kinsfolk," he said in the end. After that, Amrias added, "Your father poisoned Abu Bakr and also had Umar and Uthman eliminated. He wrongfully claimed to be the successor of Prophet. You all want to become the chief of believers while neither of you have any sense or nor capability. We called you here only to heap abuses on you, while you cannot point out any defect of ours. Do it if you can. Your father was the worst of the people and Allah saved us from his mischief. At this moment, you are under our control. Even if we kill you, there will not be anything wrong in it." Then Utbah ibn Abu Sufyan spoke up, "Your father was the worst man of Quraysh tribe. He broke off ties of relationship and shed the blood of his own kinsfolk. And you are also included among the killers of Uthman. Even if we killed you, it is our right. Though Almighty Allah destroyed your father, you are still hopeful of caliphate, which is not rightfully yours, and neither you are deserving of it." After that, Walid ibn Uqba retreated the same rubbish and in the end said, "Uthman was your best maternal uncle and the most excellent son-in-law of your family. But you people became jealous and had him killed. Now see what Almighty Allah has in store for you." The next to speak up was Mughayra bin Shu'bah, who spoke in the most insulting way about His Eminence Imam Ali, peace be upon him. And he said that Uthman was killed unjustly and your father had no justification for killing him. He gave shelters to the killer of Uthman and was pleased at the murder. It was so because Bani Umayyah is better than Bani Hashim in every aspect and Muawiyah is superior to your father. Your father was inimical to the Messenger of Allah and devised a plot to have him eliminated. But the plot was exposed and his life was saved. Then he refused to give pledge of allegiance to Abu Bakr and later had him poisoned. After that, he had Umar assassinated. Then he got Uthman murdered. Now what is your worth in the court of Almighty? Muawiyah has the right to take revenge for the murder of Uthman and the blood of Ali is not worthier than the blood of Uthman. Allah cannot gather rulership and prophethood in the family of Abdul Muttalib. When all of them concluded their nonsense, Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, began his speech. "Thanks be to Allah. He guided through our first your firsts and guided through our last your lasts. Peace be upon my grandfather, Prophet Muhammad Mustafa, peace be upon him and his pure progeny. People, listen to me and try to understand what I am saying. O Muawiyah, by Allah, these people have not cursed me, but you have cursed me out of obscenity with which you are familiar, a bad opinion for which you are famous, a bad moral to which you have stuck, and aggression against us because of an enmity from you towards Muhammad, may Allah bless him and his family. However, listen, O Muawiyah, and you listen. I will say regarding you and then something less than you have. I adjure you before Allah. O people, did you know that the person you cursed today performed prayers towards both Qiblas? As for you, O Muawiyah, you disbelieved in them. You thought they were misguidance. You worshipped Lat and Uzza out of error. I adjure you before Allah. Did you know that he pledged two allegiances? The allegiance of Fath and the allegiance of Radwan. As for you, O Muawiyah, you disbelieved in one of them and broke the other. I adjure you before Allah. Did you know that he was the most appropriate for faith? As for you, O Muawiyah, and your father, you were among those whose hearts were reconciled. You concealed unbelief and showed Islam, and you were attracted with money. I adjure you before Allah, Did you know that Imam Ali was the bearer of the standard of Allah's apostle? May Allah bless him and his family at the Battle of Badr, and that the standard of the polytheists was with Muawiyah and his father. Then he met you at the Battle of Uhud and of the allies carrying the standard of Allah's apostle. May Allah bless him and his family, while the standard of the polytheists was with your father. During all of that, Allah granted him conquest, showed his proof, supported his summons, and confirmed his speech. In all those places, Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, was pleased with him and was displeased with you and your father. I adjure you before Allah, O Muawiyah, did you remember the day when your father came riding a red camel that you drove and your brother Utbah led? Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, saw you and said, O Allah, curse the rider, the leader and the driver. Did you, O Muawiyah, forget the poetry you wrote to your father when he intended to be a Muslim and prohibit him from that? You said, O Sakhr, do not be a Muslim one day, lest you should expose us after those who were torn at the Battle of Badr. They were my maternal uncle, paternal uncle, grand uncle, the third of them, and Hanzal of good, who gifted us with sleeplessness. By Allah, what you have concealed from among your affair is greater than what you have manifested. I adjure you before Allah, O people, did you know that Ali abstained from pleasures among the companions of Allah's apostle? May Allah bless his family. So it has been revealed regarding him, O you who believe, do not forbid yourself the good things which Allah has made lawful, in Quran chapter 5 verse 87. And that Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, sent the leading companions to Bani Quraiza. They approached their stronghold and were defeated. So he sent Ali with the standard and he made them follow Allah's judgment and that of his apostle. And he did the like at Khaybar. O Muawiyah, I think that you do not know that I know what Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, said about you. When he wanted to write a letter to Bani Khuzaimah, he sent for you and you did not come to him. So he invoked Allah against you with, O Allah, until you die. And you, O people, I adjure you before Allah. Did you not know that Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, cursed Abu Sufyan in 7 places that you cannot refute? Firstly, when he met Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, who was going out of Makkah to Taif to summon Saqif to religion. Abu Sufyan attacked, cursed, stultified, abused, accused him of lying and intended to assault him. So Allah and his apostle cursed him and then the Prophet went away. Secondly, on the train of beasts of burden, Yawm al-Eer, when Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, interfered with them while they were coming from Sham. However, Abu Sufyan drove them away and made them walk by the coast. So the Muslims did not obtain them. Allah's apostle cursed him and invoked Allah against him. Accordingly, the Battle of Badr took place. Thirdly, at the Battle of Uhud, when Abu Sufyan stood at the foot of the mountain and Allah's apostle was on the top, he was calling out many times, "Exalt Hubal." So Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, cursed him 10 times and the Muslims cursed him. Fourthly, on the day when Abu Sufyan brought the allies along with the Ghaftan, the Jews, so Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, cursed him and invoked Allah against him. Fifthly, on the day when Abu Sufyan brought Quraysh and prevented Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, from the holy mosque in Makkah, and the animals of sacrifice were ready to reach their place on the day of Hudaybiyah. So Allah's apostle cursed Abu Sufyan. He cursed the leaders and the followers and said, all of them are cursed. None of them will believe. It was said, O Allah's apostle, is Islam not hoped for any of them? So how is the cursing? He said, the cursing will befall none of the followers. As for the leaders, none of them will succeed. Sixthly, on the day of the red camel. Seventhly, on the day when they stood in front of Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, to startle his she camel. They were 12 men. Among them was Abu Sufyan. So this belongs to you, O Muawiyah. Through this speech, Imam Hasan brought down Muawiyah from his palace to his grave, from his throne to his coffin. He made sadness hurt him. Then he turned to Amr ibn As and said to him, "As for you, O Ibn As, surely your affair is common. Your mother gave birth to you while you were unknown because of adultery. So four men from Quraysh sued one another about you. Her butcher overcame you. He was the meanest of them in lineage and the wickedest of them in position. Then your father rose and said, 'I detest Muhammad the childless.' So Allah revealed regarding him what he revealed. You fought against Allah's apostle. May Allah bless him and his family at all the battles. You satirized and harmed him in Makkah, and you plotted against him with all your schemes. You were the worst of all the people in accusing him of lying and enmity. Then you, along with the owners of the ship, went out intending to go to Najashi to ask him to repatriate Ja'far and his companions to the people of Makkah. When what you hoped escaped you, Allah returned you, disappointed and proved you a lying informer. When you specified your punishment against your companion Ammar bin Walid, so you informed Najashi against him as envy for what he committed with his wife. So Allah exposed you and your companion. Therefore you are the enemy of the Hashemites during the pre-Islamic period and Islam. Then you and all these people have come to know that you satirized Allah's apostle. May Allah bless him and his family with 70 verses of poetry. So Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, said, 'O Allah, surely I do not say poetry and I should not say it. O Allah, curse him 1,000 times for each letter. Therefore there are countless curses on you from Allah. As for what you have mentioned regarding Uthman's affair, it was you who set the world with fire against him. Then you went to Palestine. When you heard of his murder, you said, "I am Abu Abdullah. When I hurt an altar, I make it bleed." Then you devoted yourself to Muawiyah and sold your religion for your life in this world. Therefore, we do not blame you for hatred, nor do we admonish you for affection. By Allah, you did not support Uthman when he was alive, nor did you become angry for him when he was killed. Woe unto you, O Ibn As, did you not say regarding the Hashemites when you left Makkah for Najashi? My daughter says, "To where is this departure? And my going is not condemned." I said, "Leave me. Surely I am a man who wants to go to Najashi as to Ja'far, that I may burn him with a burning through which I set right the chivalry of the wry necked. And my affair is Ahmad, Muhammad, from among them, and I will say as to him with the abominable, and I will run to Utba diligently, even if he was like the red gold, and I will not turn away from the Hashemites, and as far as I can in absence and presence, if he accepted my admonition to him, otherwise I will draw my sword towards him. Therefore this is the answer to you. Have you heard it?" Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, mentioned what was standing in Amr ibn As from among the vices, the disgraceful acts, the violent malice against Islam and the Muslims, his taking part in shedding Uthman's blood and his joining Muawiyah's as craving after this world. Then the Imam turned to Walid ibn Uqba and said to him, "As for you, O Walid, I do not blame you for detesting Ali. That is because he whipped you 80 times as to your drinking wine, and he killed your father before Allah's apostle. May Allah bless him and his family. It is you whom Allah has called the transgressor and called Ali the believer. That was when you vied in glory with one another. You said to him, 'O Ali, keep silent. I am braver than you in heart and longer than you in tongue.' So Ali said to you, 'Keep silent, O Walid. I am a believer and you are a transgressor.' So Allah revealed his speech to confirm his speech. Is he then who is a believer like him who is a transgressor? They are not equal." Holy Quran, chapter 32, verse 18. Then he revealed to confirm his speech, "If an evildoer comes to you with a report, look carefully into it." Holy Quran, chapter 49, verse 6. "Woe unto you, O Walid, whatever you forget, do not forget the speech of the poet as to you and him." Then Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, mentioned the verses of poetry on them. "He who is a believer, may Allah prolong your life, is not like him who is transgressor, traitor. Shortly after, Walid and Ali will be openly summoned to the reckoning. Ali will be rewarded with gardens and Walid will be rewarded with disgrace. There is no relationship between you and Quraysh. You are an infidel from among the people of Sephoria. I swear by Allah that you are older in birthday than what you claim. The reason behind Walid's detesting Imam Ali, the commander of the faithful, and showing enmity towards him was that the Imam was the model of belief and Walid was the model of unbelief. It is well known that the contradiction between belief and unbelief is natural. Besides, Imam Ali, the commander of the faithful, whipped him 80 times for his drinking wine. Indeed, this brought about in himself hatred towards Imam Ali, the commander of the faithful. After Imam Hasan had disgraced Walid, he turned to Utbah ibn Abi Sufyan and said, "As for you, O Utbah, by Allah, you are not prudent to answer you, nor are you sane to debate with and admonish you. You have no good to be hoped, nor have evil to be avoided. Your reason and that of your slave girl are the same. If you openly curse Ali, that will not harm him. As for threatening me with killing, why did you not kill Layhani when you found him in your bed? Do you not feel shame of the saying of Nasr bin Hajjaj as to you? O men, occurring times and the shame that has disgraced Abu Sufyan, I have been informed that Utbah betrayed him as to his wife. He belongs to a race ignoble in origin from Lahyan. After this, I deem myself as above mentioning it because of its atrocity. So how can one fear your sword while you had not killed the one who exposed you? How can I blame you for your detesting Ali while he killed your uncle during a duel at the Battle of Badr, helped Hamza in killing your grandfather Utbah, and killed your brother Handala in one place?" Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, has explained that Utbah was foolish and had no reason and void of honor that Imam Ali, the commander of faithful, killed with his sword his grandfather, his uncle and his brother at the Battle of Badr. For this reason he harbored malice and hatred against him. Then Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, turned to Mughira bin Shu'bah and said, "As for you, O Mughira, you are not worthy of inflicting on me this and the like of it. You are like the mosquito that set to the date palm. Stand firm, for I am flying from you." The date palm said, "Did I feel that you had been sitting on me, that I might come to know that you are flying from me? We do not feel your enmity towards us, nor do we grieve if we come to know of it. Your speech is not difficult to us. The punishment prescribed by Allah as to fornication is established against you. Umar turned away from you a right about which Allah will ask him. You asked Allah's apostle, may Allah bless him and his family, can man look at the woman he wants to marry? There is no harm in it, O Mughira," he replied, "unless he had intended to fornicate her. That is because he had come to know that you were a fornicator. You are priding yourself on us through the authority. But Allah the Most High says in this concern, and when we wish to destroy a town, we send our commandment to the people of it who lead easy lives, but they transgress therein. Thus, the word proves true against it, so we destroy it with utter destruction." Holy Quran, chapter 17, verse 16. With this, the Imam's debates with his opponents came to an end. The Imam showed them their defects, their mental and genealogical vices. He exposed their disgraceful acts. He stripped them off of the garment of pride. He made sorrow and sadness hurt them. When he wanted to go away, Amr ibn As clung to his clothes and said to Muawiyah, "O commander of faithful, you have witnessed his speech as to slandering my mother. I demand him of the right of slandering." Muawiyah shouted at him with rage, "Leave him. May Allah not reward you with good." Then Muawiyah turned to his retinue. He condemned and blamed them for their disobeying and opposing him, saying, "I had told you that he was among those whose opposition was unbearable. I had prohibited you from cursing him. However, you disobeyed me. By Allah, he did not rise until he made the house dark to me. Go away from me. Indeed, Allah has exposed and disgraced you because of your leaving determination and turning away from the opinion of the compassionate adviser. And Allah is he who held his sort." Reference Ehtijaj-e-Tabrasi, Volume 1, page 413. Note, we should know that prejudiced persons can deny this incident but cannot deny the points mentioned therein. And this much is sufficient for exalting of truth that the claims of Imam Hasan are irrefutable and every allegation of the oppressors is absurd and degrading for the world as well as the year after. And peace be on those who follow the guidance. Distinctive qualities of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. The holy Imams have two types of qualities. Some are related to ordinary people as they have those qualities which are not found in other people or in holy saints. Some are related to their own family that Almighty Allah has given those qualities to each Imam particularly which are not found even in other Imams as they did not have such conditions or there was no need for them to display those qualities. Below we present an outline of both types of qualities of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Details are mentioned elsewhere. These details begin from the lineage and the time of his birth and continue till martyrdom and events after that. The first distinction of Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba, peace be upon him, is that he was the first man in humanity, both of whose parents were infallible. It is such a distinction that not even divine prophets and imams had such peculiarity. He is the first human being who is given those extra qualities whose equal is not found in the history of humanity. His respected grandfather, the Messenger of Allah, his honorable grandmother, Lady Khadija, peace be upon her, the mother of believers, his exalted father, Imam Ali, peace be upon him, his illustrious mother, Lady Fatemah Zahra, peace be upon her, his uncles, Aqil and Ja'far al-Tayyar, his paternal aunt, Hani, whose house is given the status of the sacred mosque, his grandfather, who has the honor of being the guardian of the Holy Prophet and the benefactor of Islam. We should know that even Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, is sharing these distinctions. We cannot deny the fact that Almighty Allah gave them to Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, before Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Therefore, he was unique in this regard during his time. Although it is not possible to compare the excellence among members of Ali Muhammad, as all of them are parts of the same effulgence. Reference Damatus Saqib. Childhood. During childhood, when most children spend their time playing, and that is why the Holy Quran has also considered this point and called the life of the world to be a game and play in the beginning and later to be a matter of pride. The young members of Al Muhammad have those qualities which cannot be imagined in others. For example, so strong was the power of smell of Imam Hasan that as soon as he entered the house, he told his mother, "I can feel the fragrance of my grandfather," which also shows that the power of perception of the Holy Infallible is stronger than others. It also shows that the body of the prophethood has a fragrance which all cannot feel and which requires power of smell like that of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him. Reference Hadith-e-Qisa. So strong was the sight of Imam Hasan that when Imam Ali wanted to hear the explanation of his son, he immediately said, "Mother, today my tongue has no fluency. It seems as if my master is watching me." Reference Biharul Anwar, Volume 10, page 193. Through this, Imam Hasan also clarified that Holy Prophet has declared me to be the chief of the youths of paradise, but I am calling my father master so that all may know that when he cannot be compared to people like me, what to say about other people of community. Special merits and excellence. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, was unique in this regard also, which is in comparison to the ordinary persons of the Ummah and from aspects as opposed to other members of Ahlul Bayt. For example, he is the first human being to have got the honor of entering the Yamani cloak and was considered to be the first cure of the weakness of the Prophet. Reference Hadith-e-Qisa. He was the most prominent among the persons who came out to confront the Christian delegation in the field of Mubahila, as in spite of such young age, he came into field on his own and Holy Prophet placed him before all and gave him the honor of walking by himself. Reference Hayatul Qulub, Volume 2, Chapter 47, page 754. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, is also included among the persons because of whose illness Surah Hal Ata was revealed and for whose recovery fasts were kept. And no other than Imam Hasan and Imam Hussein, peace be upon them, have this distinction. Reference Tafsir-e-Namuna. Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, is also included among the persons whose love is made incumbent by Almighty Allah. The most important point is that at the time he was very young age, and during childhood a person is not even aware of prophetic teachings. How can his love be fixed as a recompense of prophethood? But Almighty Allah gave this distinction to Imam Hasan at such a young age. In this same young age, Holy Prophet declared that he was the chief of the youths of paradise. Reference: Biharul Anwar, Volume 10, Chapter 6, page 58. During that time, he declared their Imamat and said that both his sons were Imams, whether they stand up or keep sitting. Imam Hasan received the honor of being the flower of the Prophet and the grandson of the Messenger during this time. Reference: Biharul Anwar, Volume 10, Chapter 2, page 56. Youth. During his youth, when he got the opportunity to display his physical strength and valor, he displayed that incomparable bravery in the Battle of Siffin, whose equal is not found in the history of Islam. And Imam Ali has so much extolled him that when Muhammad ibn Hanafiya said, "Every time you send only me into the battlefield," he said, "You are my son, and these two are the sons of the Messenger of Allah." Reference: Hayatul Qulub. Period of Imamat. The period of his leadership began in such difficult times that such a thing was unprecedented. He led the first congregation at a time when his wounded father sat in the prayer niche. He was bleeding from the head and his beard was being dyed in blood, while Imam Hasan led the prayers with utmost attention and sincerity. The second hardship that he faced was that he could not openly bury a father who had departed from the world after becoming the Caliph of Muslims, and in whose grief the whole Islamic world mourned. It was so because he was absolutely aware of the oppressions of Sham and the disloyalty and shamelessness of Muslim community, and it was feared that if the location of the grave is known to all, it can be desecrated any time. Just as the Muslims had planned to open the grave of his honorable mother and had detested only because of the fury of Imam Ali. The third great difficulty that he faced was that circumstances compelled him to make peace with a person about whom he was certain that he was the killer of his father, and he had provided the means to Ibn Muljim to carry out the heinous act, although a conspiracy was hatched to make the motive clouded. But he signed the peace treaty with him, showing that they did not prefer the Islamic matters to their personal matters. Although so serious the situation was that even some of his friends had begun to refer him as insult to believers. As a matter of fact, it is an easy matter to fight the killer of one's father and take revenge. But it is so difficult to make peace with him and to hand over power to him that other than Imam Hasan, none can do it. Another distinction of Imam Hasan, peace be upon him, is also that through this treaty, he was able to make the ruler of Sham confess to his irreligiosity as well as oppression. Thus, he stipulated the condition that Muawiyah would have to act according to Quran and Sunnah, and also that he would have to discontinue the system of cursing Imam Ali, peace be upon him, from the pulpits, which obviously meant that Quran and Sunnah were not being followed and the curses were being recited on Imam Ali, peace be upon him. By mentioning Sunnah of the Prophet, he made it clear that other than Sunnah of the Prophet, there was no scope of any other Sunnah in Islam, and following any other practice was opposed to spirit of Islam. Imam Ali had declared this verbally, but Imam Hasan got it in writing from the ruler of Sham. Another distinction of his is that he mentioned such conditions in the treaty about which it was known that the ruler of Sham would not honor, and in this way, Islamic world would become aware of his intention. Thus, when he violated all the terms of the treaty and trampled on the document, and someone said to Imam Hasan that you have been deceived, he replied in the most beautiful way, "Thank God I have not deceived anyone." In this way, he got admission of community also that the ruler of Sham was a cheater, and made him aware that one who tramples the treaty which was signed in the name of God and Prophet cannot be a Muslim. Another distinction of his is that even after this behavior of the ruler of Sham, he continued to honor the terms of the treaty and did not violate them on any occasion. On the contrary, he arranged that even after he passed away, Bani Hashim would not be able to violate the terms of the treaty, and Ali Muhammad should not be blamed for violating a pledge. Martyrdom. Another distinction of Imam Hasan is that he was the first martyr to be eliminated through poison. Before this, in the life history of Prophet, such issues are mentioned, but martyrdom of Imam Hasan is a confirmed fact and which even the Muslim historians have confessed, even though they have also tried to make the identity of the killer to be doubtful. Through his martyrdom, Imam Hasan also clarified that relationship of wifehood is not a guarantee of good character, and a wife having a bad character can even eliminate her husband. And if worldly desires become dominant, a person can do anything. Shower of arrows on the buyer is also one of his distinctive qualities whose equal is not found in history before that. Not being able to be buried besides the Prophet is included among his distinctive qualities, which can well demonstrate the shamelessness and disloyalty of Islamic Ummah, that companions of Prophet can get a place next to Prophet, but the son of Prophet cannot get a place next to his grandfather. Allegations. Another aspect of the life of Imam Hasan is also that the Muslim community did not accept him as a caliph, like the personalities of caliphs were accepted before that, as a result of which Banu Umayyah started making allegations against him. The first allegation was that of multiple marriages, and different types of reports were fabricated about it. In taking it as a basis, Christianity supported Banu Umayyah fully, as the court of Muawiyah was full of Christian representatives. Muawiyah's wife and Yazid's mother was also Christian, and the personal physician of Muawiyah was also a follower of Christianity. And the issue of multiple marriages is the greatest attack on the character of a person in view of Christianity, just as the greatest act against Islam is justification of polygamy. Thus, in the beginning, this issue was used against the Prophet and later against Imam Hasan. The secret is that in Christian faith, marriage has no merit at all. Among Christians, the exemplary character of woman is Lady Maryam, and she never married. Among the men, the exemplary character is that of Prophet Isa, and he also never married. As a result of this, the world of Christianity remained unaware of significance of marriage, and it developed a view that marriage was against spirituality and the greatness of character. Wherever it saw two or four marriages, or whomsoever it decided to defame, it used the propaganda of multiple marriages, or it was used as an evidence of the weakness of his character. The next allegation on Imam Hasan was that of cowardice, and the same thing was alleged about Holy Prophet and Imam Ali before. But at that time, circumstances were different, so they did not have to face the conditions that Imam Hasan had to face. And in spite of this difficulty, he continued his mission, and he did not give any pretext to the oppressor to misuse it and eliminate Bani Hashim or followers of Al Muhammad. Another distinction of Imam Hasan is that in order to protect the community, he adopted a way that was not customary before. On one hand, he protected community without use of force, and on the other hand, he appointed the worst enemy of Islam to be a defender of faith, and that the Banu Umayyah, who since the first day were involved in anti-Islamic activities, their hero, Muawiyah, apparently became the defender of Islamic boundaries, and it was a great feat of practical wisdom of Imam Hasan, whose equal is not found in the history of the world.